The Center for Educational Media and the College of Education at Middle Tennessee State University are proud to offer professional development to K-12 educators in Tennessee through our online video library. The following video is presented by the Center for Educational Media in partnership with Professional Educators of Tennessee's Leader U Conference. For more professional development videos, check out our website at www.mtsu.edu/CEM.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our after lunch Leader U presentation sessions. This afternoon, we are going to listen to Christy Ballard. And my name is Dr. Tavia McLeod, and I am a PET board member. But Christy, she has served as the general counsel at the Tennessee Department of Education for 20 years. She started as a staff attorney in 2000, focusing on special education law. She has since served as chief legal officer for the agency, advising the commissioner, other agency personnel, and the state special schools on legal issues. Her responsibilities include overseeing the work of the TDOE attorneys and analyzing education-related legislation.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. August 7th will be my 23-year anniversary with the department. So like she said, I was the special ed attorney. I did a brief stint at HCA right out of law school in healthcare. But while I'm not an educator, I was raised by educators. My mother is a retired 7th grade math teacher from rural West Tennessee. I have an aunt who's a retired 4th grade teacher and another aunt who's a retired high school teacher. So I actually worked on a MAT, the Master's in the Art of Teaching at University of Memphis after I got my bachelor's, thinking, well, I'm going to teach, but I always kind of wanted to go to law school. And so I finished that first year of that master's program. I don't know what I'd be now. That's been a lot of years ago. I'm actually probably was 12 credits shy in student teaching short of a license, and a social studies group endorsement is what I was working on at the time. And of course, after being at the department, I did a brief little stopover at the Tennessee School Boards Association for about a year and a half, and I met one of the assistant commissioners at the Department of Education at the time over special ed, Joe Fisher, and he said, I need a special ed attorney. And I said, well, that's the one area of school law I don't feel comfortable. And he said, oh, come on, you can learn it. So I did, and I loved it, and I became general counsel a couple years later. So I wish now I had finished that master's in education. I feel like it'd give me a little more credibility if I'd finished that. But I've enjoyed working with educators, and I always feel privileged to talk to actual teachers who are boots on the ground. It helps inform my practice. It helps me give better advice to the department. It helps me give better trainings when I go out and do in-service trainings for educators. So glad to be here. So thanks for having me. This is an important topic and one that sometimes you get into uncomfortable areas, and we're going to kind of navigate those because this is required training. So, teacher code of ethics. Can anybody, or does anybody want to tell me what they think the purpose of a teacher code of ethics? And is it different from a code of conduct? Because you hear those things, you know, talked about a lot. Code of conduct, code of ethics. When I first got out of law school and when I was at that healthcare company, it was, you know, corporate. They're developing core values and codes of ethics and codes of conduct. So everybody does it. It doesn't matter if you're in government or private sector, all professions really. Lawyers, we have a code of ethics that we are supposed to follow. I really think a code of ethics is more general. It clarifies the general mission. It gives you more the core values of a profession, where a code of conduct is more specific. Don't do this or do this. I think it's interesting, the Tennessee Teacher Code of Ethics has been around for a long time. It used to live on the Tennessee Educator Association's website, but it has always been mentioned in the code. as far back as when I started in my journey in education law at the department in 2000, because it's always been a thing that everyone knew was out there, and it was listed in the Tennessee Code as a reason for which a person could lose their job, possibly, if they violate the teacher code of ethics. Here are the positive things I think a code of ethics does. I think what we have now is, I think it was about 2018 or maybe a few years before that, they actually printed it and posted it, included it as part of Tennessee law. And in 2018, they tweaked it a little bit, some major revisions, and they added things in the law like teachers. All teachers have to have an annual training. So, yeah, you didn't think you were going to have a test right after lunch. I'm not going to take it up. You don't have to write it down. But just think about these questions as we go along. And feel free to shout out the answer if you feel inclined. All right, true or false? Teachers may never accept gifts from students.
False.
Everybody pretty sure on that answer? Nobody says true? Okay. Well, you're right. False. Teachers are prohibited from tutoring students for pay after school hours. True or false?
False.
I have a qualifying question. Is this public schools, private schools, all teachers? What is
We're talking about public school teachers right now.
If it is the subject that they are teaching,
does it make a difference? And that's good, because sometimes facts, well, not sometimes, all times, facts matter. And you can tweak the facts with a question or a scenario, and it might change the answer. But in general, if you're a math teacher and you tutor kids after school, may you never tutor anybody in math. Is that a true or false statement?
So in the district that I'm in, we're not allowed to tell a parent that their child needs tutoring and then offer to charge them for tutoring.
I think that's what I'm getting at, and that's a good point, because generally this answer is false. Because I remember when this language was added to the Teacher Code of Ethics, and there was a lot of discussion in legislative committee hearings about, well, this would just stop all teachers from tutoring. No. Now, your example is a very good one. Does that mean you can say, well, Miss Ballard, Christy's having a little trouble with fractions, but if you'll pay me $300 an hour right after school, I'll make sure she gets up to speed. Now, obviously, that would not be ethical to teach or to tutor a current student of yours on things that they're learning in your classroom. But does that mean that when that student is no longer a student of yours, or during the summer, you just have to think about the optics and the specific facts. So, and your school board ought to have some parameters and procedures and maybe some rules of thumb about when it's appropriate and when it's not. But this code of ethics does not in any way prohibit teachers from tutoring.
Well, Ms. Ballard, I think it was unethical to charge $300 an hour.
that may be a different question, what you may charge.
How about location? Can they use the school space for profit?
That's a great question. Can you use the school space? Well, I think that depends on local board policy. And there are some local board policies about facilities use agreements. Now, we all know that schools in the community are for the community, and they're used for many purposes. And it may be the Baptist church, the roof blew off of it last Sunday with a tornado, and maybe they're meeting the next Sunday and they're following the local facilities use agreement, or it may be the Boy Scouts, or it may be just a community group that meets. It depends on what they allow, but I think you should be very cautious being a school district employee using the school for personal gain. And always, if you have questions about that, talk to your principal and maybe the director, and they can talk to their local board attorney to look at the current law that applies to your facts and applies to their board policy. But that's a really keen observation. Teachers are only responsible for the behavior of students assigned to their classes. True or false?
False.
I think that's an easy one. Through the years, when I've done an investigation or training, and I've had somebody say, well, I saw it happening in the hall, but it wasn't my student. We all know that all students are all of our students, so it does not matter if they're assigned to you necessarily. A teacher may pass out flyers and recommend his spouse's salon to students and parents as long as he does it during lunch or other non-instructional time.
False.
That's just a red flag that, you know, promoting a personal business, it doesn't matter if it's your personal or a member of your immediate family. We know that that's just kind of a no-no. We'll talk more about some of these scenarios. The teacher code of ethics only applies to a teacher's actions while they are working and may never impact their private life.
False.
The point I always like to make, if you're a teacher, you have every right to a personal life. But we all know there are certain things you can do on Friday or Saturday night. You're not going to remain a kindergarten teacher. And while I think it's funny, I think teachers are almost put on a pedestal and treated kind of like members of the clergy. That we have expectations for our teachers that we don't, I mean, I don't have to, lawyers, nobody expects anything from lawyers, so they don't put us on a pedestal. Every joke is about lawyers now, and I get to hear all of them. But you just have to be cautious, and there are things that you can do in your personal time that can impact your ability to be an effective teacher or for your students and parents to feel like you can be an effective teacher. Okay, if you want to go to Tennessee law, Title 49, most of you all probably know that that's the education code. Chapter 5 is where most of the provisions on employees and employment are, and Part 10 is where you find this code of ethics. But here are all the different provisions about teacher code of ethics. Now, what I said earlier is for years, it's always been listed like, you know that if you're a tenured teacher, you can only be terminated for cause. And one of the causes listed in the law would be violation of the teacher code of ethics. In 2018, when this law was revised, it's not just about termination of employment. They added violation of the teacher code of ethics could also result in the State Board of Education taking action against your license. So that's a big deal. And so it's not just about you can't work here, you can't work anywhere because you won't have a license. Now, does that mean every little oopsie that happens, the State Board would take your license? No, absolutely not. And that's something that people were concerned about. It would have to be something extremely serious, and they have things that are precedent setting. And now, thankfully, when I first started, the only actions available to the State Board in the rule and in the law were either revoke the license or not. And now there is a menu of options, and it may just be a public censor that's like, hey, you did that, don't do it again. And that's helpful because there are times when the State Board feels like this is an action that's worthy of something, but we don't think a teacher should lose their license and their career over it. We just want to make sure that they understand that that is something that should not have happened and should not happen in the future. So. Now, just wanted to put this slide out there, and I think this really feels a lot like a code of ethics and core values because it's basically the language directly from the General Assembly. An educator believing in the worth and dignity of each human being recognizes the supreme importance of the pursuit of truth, devotion to excellence, and the nurture of democratic principles. I'm not going to read all of it to you, but that really feels like a guiding principle. It's a core value that educators should always use to drive all their decision making. It's not a list of do's and don'ts. It's a value and a standard for the profession. So we've got that statement. And you have to have annual training. So I do this a lot, and I know that Pat always uses, this will be posted. I'm probably going to record something similar to this, and it's going to go on the department's website. I've been hearing from directors of schools, and you know, it would be helpful, they tell me, to not have to put everybody in the cafeteria for a day and sit through this, that if you could just click through and have it available. And that is my mission now that the pandemic's over, and I'm hoping to have the resources to put more things on our website, on the legal page, just so anything that's a legally required training that my team can do and post, and your district can just say, hey, document that you've done this, and then you don't have to sit in the cafeteria for hours listening to lawyers.
Yeah, one thing, we're always glad to post anything you want us to, you know that.
And what I'll do is probably when we start posting things on our website, I'll send you and you can link to it. because we're going to have things like my civil rights attorney will have bullying training, because that's an annual thing that all educators have to take, and things like that. I mean, obviously there are a lot of other trainings the department does, but there are a few that legal, my team, does traditionally. This is a big one that everyone was worried about a little bit when it first passed. An educator who has knowledge of a breach by another educator of the Teacher Code of Ethics has to report. So you breach the Teacher Code of Ethics if you know of another teacher breaching it and you don't report it. That's uncomfortable, and I will tell you, this: we have the same duty as attorneys. If I know of an attorney who is violating our code of ethics, I'm legally obligated to report that. And that's a tough thing. And sometimes you don't want to, you risk, well, I'm not sure if this is a violation and should I report it or not. And what I always encourage leaders at school districts to do is give people grace, train them and talk to them, and say that good faith efforts will never be punished. If you are reporting out of good faith because you believe. And I always think that even though you have this annual training, and sometimes the trainings you get in a room and you read it, I think it's good to have discussions about codes of ethics and maybe hypotheticals, and let teachers sit in a room and freely, not disclosing, you know, confidential information or personally identifiable things, but, you know, discuss in a way, because there's some things that are very black and white. We can all look and say, it's a shame we even have to talk about this. But there are other things that are nuanced, and there are gray areas. And like the thing that you brought up, can you do it, you know, on school grounds? And it's good to have those robust discussions so that people feel more confident about when they, you know, encounter a situation. Like I said, failure to report is a breach. Now, this is the nitty-gritty, this is the list, and this is where I think our teacher code of ethics has some broad statements that really feel like a code of ethics, you know, standards for the profession, core values, and then there's some others that feel very much like a code of conduct, where it's like, don't do this, or do this, and it's a little more specific. And I think it all works together. So I'm going to give you this list. Some of them, I'm not going to read everyone out. Some of them I'll put in red, and I want to talk about a little bit more. Here they are. Not unreasonably restrain the student from independent action in the pursuit of learning. That feels more general and more like a core value. Provide the student with professional education services in a non-discriminatory manner and in consonance with accepted best practices known to the educator. You will also, when you start reading these, there is a little bit of redundancy. There are some things that are covered in different words, but they kind of mean the same thing. Respect the constitutional rights of students. Discrimination, constitutional rights, you know, that's a, you know, that kind of can mean the same thing. Okay, here's a good one. Not unreasonably deny the student access to varying points of view. You know, we hear a lot about public schools, and whether it's on the college level or K-12 level, there are criticisms saying that, well, sometimes students are being indoctrinated. You ever hear that? And I think this is a good reminder that when you're teaching, the role is for students to access varying points of view. And in the same way that you don't want to shut down discussion, you want to teach students how to have a calm and adult discussion when opinions are different. You want to make sure that you are providing access to different thoughts and opinions. And maybe you as a teacher, maybe you need to check yourself and think about, am I only talking about what I personally believe in, or am I truly letting students access varying points of view? As an attorney, I tell my attorneys, when you go out and present, you're a lawyer, you're not a policymaker. Government lawyers, we're not policymakers, we're the lawyers. We're to help the policymakers implement whatever policy they come up with. And it doesn't matter what our personal opinion is. And if I hear one of my attorneys presenting and I feel like I can tell what their personal belief is, I'm gonna check them on it. I'm gonna say that it's, you're just the lawyer. You don't have a personal opinion. On the clock anyway. Now, obviously everybody has a right to their own personal opinions off the clock, but not during work time. Can anybody think of an example of where this could go wrong, or have you thought about it?
So I teach social studies and science. And in science, I'm in a very conservative community. And so the kids, what we always talk about, it always comes up somehow during the year, like evolution, creation, things like that. And so here's the three ways we say is that you might believe the earth is millions of years old, but they argue with the people who say it's billions of years old. Said you might believe God did it in 7 days, like the Bible says, or you might believe that God chose to use evolution for creation. And I said, but these conversations are ones you have at home with your parents. What do your family, what do you believe? Because the kids always bring this up. And as they kind of start to argue a little with each other, I always put it back and say, that's a great conversation to have at home. What do you believe?
I think that's one of the most cited examples of people who have varying beliefs and they feel strongly about those beliefs. And I think especially in when you talk about current events in classrooms, there are some very, you know, controversial things people can hear on the news. And depending on whether or not it's an age-appropriate discussion for students, it's a good time to teach them that people can disagree. So it's just a good core value of the code of ethics.
Could you speak to the reasonable, what, give that a little bit of definition or test?
That and that's what's
is
good.
Is that community standard based? Is that how you would
maybe
define that?
I think making sure that in allowing students to share their beliefs, they do it in a way that doesn't harm another student. I think when you talk about not unreasonably denying access to varying opinions, I think that you're going to look at, is it appropriate for the discussion of the classroom? And I've had teachers say, well, when we're talking about a certain topic and I'm asked a pointed question about my belief, can I answer it and when can I not answer it? And I said, well, I think it's, be cautious, talk to your board attorney, but also, is it an appropriate question for the topic you're currently discussing? Because I think that happens more often than we're talking about this very specific current event and we've got two varying opinions and I'm guiding the discussion and making sure that students are polite and respectful. And I think that's, if the discussion becomes something where it's not respectful to maybe the other opinion, I think that's when you talk about, you know, the reasonableness. They're not good black and white answers for these kinds of things, but I think these are the kind of discussions you should have with colleagues about, like when this comes up in my class, because we teach this every unit, how do you handle it and how would you? I think of, I got a call years ago where there was a teacher in a government class and they would bring in people running, because they were talking about the election process, but they only brought in people to speak with a certain affiliation with a certain position or a certain party. And I said, well, you know, if you're gonna bring people in, you need to be really careful about that. And obviously, anytime you bring in guest speakers, always follow your board policy, talk to your administrator about whether or not that's something that they want to allow. Hard questions. Make reasonable, and you're gonna see the word reasonable everywhere. And this law does not, in the Code of Ethics, does not define reasonable. Make reasonable effort to protect the student from conditions harmful to learning or to health and safety. Now, when I think about this, I think of bullying. That's the one that always comes up, and things that happen at night on Facebook, and you know, your obligation, if you have knowledge that something's going on, it doesn't matter if the kid's in your class, you see it going on in the hallway, take reasonable action to ensure that students are safe and well. Can anybody else think of another example of this?
Blocking certain web sites, yeah.
I think that's a good example of, you know, the internet, it's like a blessing and a curse. It provides a great learning tool, but we also know that students can be harmed by content on it, and making sure that they're knowledgeable about the unsafe things that can happen online, and making sure parents understand, and making sure that students and parents understand your acceptable use policy when you're using school equipment or you're using the internet at school, and to report things.
Knox County had probably the best example of this last year, where they had the case where they had to have everybody wear masks longer than at the rest of the state because of a few kids who sued. And the problem was they didn't have the exceptions from the year before, and there's kids who can't wear the masks for health and safety. So you had this dichotomy of these kids say that these parents said, my kid, everybody has to wear it because they have this issue health-wise. But then there was children that the year before, there was a list of who could be exempted from the mask, and they were not exempted. So their health and safety was, so you had like opposition because.
Oh, you're reminding me of the pandemic, and boy, I mean, I know I had a rough time, and I know you all in the classrooms did. And that was, you talk about people who felt strongly about different things, and you're right. That is an example of where leaders have to get together and come up with the best answer for a situation. And sometimes things result in litigation. Okay. Not intentionally expose the student to embarrassment or disparagement. I always think of student discipline when it comes to this, and I think about the old days when teachers would draw a circle on the blackboard and say, Johnny, go put your nose in the circle, or I remember the old pictures of the kids setting the old cartoons with the dunce hat on and the little pointed. I think we know we don't do that now. We don't punish to embarrass students. And I always think of the word discipline, and where does that word discipline come from? To teach, right? To correct behavior, to teach appropriate behavior. So it's not to embarrass or disparage students. So we know we don't do those things anymore. I also think about, a lot of people use examples about like coaches who maybe yell and are extreme and use it to embarrass students or make students the butt of a joke. I just would caution educators to be very cautious about anything where you're making the student a butt of a joke or the purpose of your action is to embarrass rather than to correct behavior. Okay, and this goes back to the language about constitutional violations, not on the basis of race, color, creed, disability, sex, national origin, marital status, political or religious beliefs, family, social or cultural background, or sexual orientation unfairly, exclude the student from participation in any program, deny benefits to the student, or grant any advantage to the student. I mean, this is a direct quote from the Teacher Code of Ethics in the law. And I think most people are very familiar with that. Not use the educator's professional relationship with the student for private advantage. That goes back to my hair salon and advertising personal businesses. So be very cautious about if you have a family business or a personal business. Not disclose information about the student obtained in the course of the educator's professional service unless disclosure of the information is permitted, serves a compelling professional purpose, or is required by law. Now this one I think is interesting because we know there's a federal law and really state law that protects personally identifiable student information that are things that are contained in a record. That's FERPA. But remember, FERPA applies to records. What if it's an observation you've had in the classroom? Does that mean it's okay to, is that a violation of FERPA to go to your weekend barbecue and tell, guess what happened in my class today? Little Johnny did X, Y. That might not be a violation of FERPA because you're not disclosing information in records. You're disclosing something that you observed in your classroom. But it might still be a violation of the Teacher Code of Ethics. And I think that's one nuance that a lot of educators don't think about. Just because it's not a FERPA violation, because it's not a disclosure of records that is unauthorized by law, having those faculty lounge conversations or sharing at a, you know, family event or a friend's event after work, it can still be a violation of the Teacher Code of Ethics if it's not disclosed for an appropriate reason. So be cautious about that. Be cautious about what you post on social media. I get calls a lot from school officials who say, well, this was posted by this teacher on Twitter or the Snapchat or whatever they're using. Now, they didn't put the kid's name, but we all know who they're talking about. And I have seen some very smart people use some very poor judgment on social media. And we'll talk a little bit more about that, but I will say, I think it's great to have social media accounts. Now, I personally use mine for what they were intended, to post pictures of my little 6-pound poodle in dresses and Nobody's ever going to get their feelings hurt because Delta Rose is in a dress on Facebook, or she has her own Instagram account though. But be really careful about posting about work. When I very seldom post anything but Delta Rose, but if I post anything about work, it's like headed to Leader U to speak to educators, going to be a fun, I mean, it's that kind of thing. Talking to school nurses, you know, unsung heroes of the school, you know, things like that. Not knowingly make false or malicious statements about students or colleagues. That's kind of obvious. All right. Ensure interactions with the student take place in transparent and appropriate settings. What do you think that means?
Where you speak to the child, like in your classroom or not in a closed space?
It's being smart. It's protecting yourself. Because what do we know? Sometimes you're accused, there are false allegations against you.
No chat rooms.
Yeah, you have to think about even avoiding the appearance of impropriety. And when you're creating those boundaries between you and student, you can make a great difference in a student's life while you're still their teacher. You're not their buddy, you're their teacher, and you are going to observe those boundaries. When I say transparent settings, they're just, you know, if you need to tutor students after school, there are times you can't avoid one-on-one interaction with students. But what you're going to think about is you're not going to do it in the basement, under the boiler room door with the door shut. You're going to do it in a classroom or, you know, in a well-trafficked area of the school if it's after school with the door open. And I love that classrooms that have windows that go into the hallway, what do y'all like to do with those?
Cover them up.
Because it's a distraction, right? When you're teaching and every person that walks by, you see your whole class, they're all their face. But you know what's good about those windows being open? There are certain times that you like that, because people can see in and out. It protects you from false accusations if it's like between periods and there's a kid in your class talking to you privately. Sometimes it's a good thing.
I don't work at a public school, but we have a lot of these rules. One of our rules is, I work middle school, we have email that's their school email because they use it to sign in. They may only email the teacher using the school email. If they email us from home, we actually write back and say, please email using, we'll answer the question, and we always put somebody else on it, but they're told, open up your school email at home and email us, because therefore it's like moderated by everybody.
And I'm not saying all of these, this teacher code of ethics, it does have an impact on licensure. So I'm not saying that all of these things don't apply to a private school setting if you have a Tennessee teacher license. But those are good points, and I'm going to get to a little bit more about that because I agree. Now, this is the one that is like, but the General Assembly wanted to make sure that there was no doubt that no teacher was going to get in a situation where they were accused of an action and not completely understand prohibited behavior. So it's very detailed. Not engage in any sexually related behavior with the student. Now, people ask, well, what is sexually related behavior? Whether verbal, written, physical, or electronic, with or without the student's consent, sexually related behavior includes, but is not limited to, behavior such as making sexual jokes, sexual remarks, engaging in sexual kidding, sexual teasing, or sexual innuendo, pressuring the student, and that's the one that I think they really debated, you know, wanted to make clear that telling a joke that is inappropriate is included in that definition of sexually related behavior. Now, when you get down to the end of that, pressuring student for dates, I mean, most people understand sexual favors, and then you get to the more damaging and the more problematic behavior. And I also like to bring up, when I do in-service, even though you're not actually ever telling an inappropriate sexual joke, what if you're standing around a bunch of students who are? Do you think your behavior or reaction to that is important? Because what happens if the favorite teacher listens and hears and says nothing? And even worse, what if that teacher actually laughs at the joke? Is that as damaging almost as telling it yourself?
Mm-hmm.
You're teaching those students, and they look up to that favorite teacher, so if you think it's funny and appropriate, obviously it's okay. I think those are the teachable moments when not only do you not engage in the back and forth with students, it's important that you use that as a teachable moment to teach students what is and is not appropriate behavior. I mean, not furnish alcohol, that's kind of obvious. Strive to prevent the use. Refrain from the use of alcohol in front of students on LEA premises. Maintain a professional approach with the student at all times. I think that's getting back to those setting those appropriate boundaries. And a lot of times, you know, I get calls about a particular educator, or I'm talking with the general counsel who's over the State Board of Education, Angie Sanders, and that's the agency that takes licensure action. And there's a complaint or an investigation where maybe that teacher did not cross that line, but they're teetering very close. And it's the teachers who, sometimes what I found, who work too hard to be the friend or the buddy of the students. I mean, they're the ones that, they know who's dating who, and they want to help counsel about every relationship, and they want to, not only do they know where the party is on Friday night, they might go to the party. Those are people, now I would submit to you, they've already crossed the line. But, and what's the biggest problem of that is, if a false allegation is made against a teacher that behaves that way with students, and maybe it's not even true, would people be more likely to believe it? Because they've observed the way that teacher has interacted and has not set those proper boundaries. And sometimes it's, you have teachers who are younger, they're teaching high school level, and they're not that much older than the kids. But I will tell you a story that I always include on my slides, sentences about, it doesn't matter your age or your gender, it's never appropriate to have a relationship with a student. And when I put that aside, people just look at me like, why are you putting that on there? We know that. I was at a statewide conference years ago, and I did an hour and a half on sexual harassment. And I had a guy come up at the break, and he said, Ms. Ballard, if I've got an 18-year-old student and she's willing, is that sexual harassment? And at first I thought, well, is he trying to be funny? And he was dead serious. And I said, well, it might not be a crime for which you would go to jail, but you will be famous when your name is announced at the next state board meeting and your license is being revoked and it's reported to the national database and you can't go anywhere in the United States and get another teaching license because of this bad act that's on your record. And he went, oh. And he disappeared, didn't come back after the break. He wasn't that stupid though, because he'd removed his name tag so I could not see what district he was from. But it kind of reminded me that there's a difference between a crime, and there are some statutes about authority figures where the age of the individuals is not as important, but I had to make the point, you might not go to jail, but you're gonna lose your profession. And obviously, it's a violation of the teacher code of ethics.
Ms. Ballard, this hasn't been in my recent years, but when I was a young teacher, I would always put another shirt in my car. If I had on my school shirt in my car on Friday afternoon going to happy hour, because I didn't want my school shirt to be at the bar, you know.
I think that's very smart, and I've talked to school leaders through the years. It depends on the community, and I know people that, you know, it didn't matter if they were watching the Super Bowl and might want to partake in a six pack. They did not buy it within their county lines because nobody. I remember when I saw my third grade teacher, Miss Bowman, in the grocery store in blue jeans. And that was back when teachers didn't wear jeans. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was just taken aback. I mean, because we hold teachers to this standard. So not to say that was fair to not expect her to wear blue jeans to the grocery store, but it is. It's a real thing, and I do think that you should be cautious. There are certain things that I do as a government employee. When I used to travel a lot more, and I still now, we occasionally, if you're in a state car, somebody will report you. I've had people in our agency that almost got, we used to have like the state seal on the door. That's not a good, because you don't want to drive in some areas with State of Tennessee seal, because they don't know you're educated. They think you're, you know, something else. And it's not as a, you don't get a very friendly reception. But I had a complaint years ago because one of my employees, they took pictures and sent it in of a state car with a license plate parked at a local mall during the workday. And they said, you know, no state employee ought to be shopping during the workday. And what happened, this was a person who was on the road all week long, traveling from district to district doing monitoring. Well, she broke a heel on her shoe. Only pair of shoes she had, she ran in the mall to get another pair of shoes. And yeah, it was during the workday, but she spent the night on the road. She wasn't going home to her family every night. So there are always circumstances. But, and then I said, you didn't do anything wrong, but this just reminds us that appearance matters. And just, this is, you know, perception is a real thing. Okay, interaction with students and potential liability. Let's talk about those areas. I always put that sentence in honor of that guy that came up to me at the break, you know, doesn't matter. Showing affection. Now, I am a lawyer and I assess risk. You always have to think about who is presenting. If you want to avoid any risk of liability, don't touch kids. Now, I get booed if I'm talking to pre-K or elementary, they're like, we're going to love those babies. That may be the only love. I get that. I'm just telling you, if you want to avoid all risk of liability, and I've seen the training do the side hug, and you know, if you want to avoid risk, don't touch them. I get that. I'm just giving you something to talk about. School social events. Staff attends to monitor for behavior and safety. You're not necessarily there to interact. Just something to think about. I remember when I first became general counsel and I had about 15 calls from one community over the behavior of one junior high teacher at a junior high dance. I heard about the song her and the student danced to, where the hands were, where they sat in the bleachers. I reported it to the director of schools, and I don't know what was true or not. But if she had not been out dancing with, yeah, we wouldn't have gotten the commissioner of education, and that's kind of the fun and maybe not so fun sometimes role is in the department. When you want to call and talk to the commissioner of education and they don't know where to send the call, legal, we usually get it. But we get lots of calls like that about behavior of a teacher, and a lot of time, I mean, most of those are local issues. We refer it back to the local. Because we don't manage and control public schools. You all have boards and directors for that.
And one thing that you have to use common sense, and today's common sense, if you're going to participate, as you just said, you might as well get ready. Somebody's videotaping it on the phone.
You are right. That is a very good point.
So I've always been told, you know, don't do anything that you're not going to be proud and be able to stand before your board of education said I did.
Everybody's got a little mini video camera in their pocket. And it doesn't matter if your policy says students may not video, you assume you're being recorded. Every time I talk to an angry person on the phone, I assume they're recording it. Every time I do an internal investigation about, you know, an employment matter, sometimes I say, are you recording this? And they go, well, no, they may be, but at least they're going to lie to me on the recording.
So we have Chromebooks. Every student has a Chromebook. Many districts do that. And we discovered this year the kids were videoing on their Chromebooks and saving the clips. So they were videoing a lot of teachers teaching. And so we had to have them go in and delete everything because they were taking those out of the building and they can't have photographs of other students. So we could use that as a justification, but they still have the ability to record.
I'm so glad y'all brought this up because if you Google bad teacher or something, I mean, and students will goad you and almost create a situation where you may lose your cool and you're being recorded at maybe not your finest moment. So always assume you're being recorded because even if you have rules and you know, once it's out there on the internet, it's a thing. So, I mean, that is a very good point. Tutoring, counseling, or check-ins. Avoid isolated locations. We've already talked about this. Just don't do it under the gym, behind the boiler room with the door closed. Well-trafficked areas. Protect yourself. Be smart. Use common sense. Although I've had a friend who says common sense is not so common. Off-campus interaction. proceed with caution. The same communities that you teach in, you live in. You go to church with families that, you know, are in your class. You have children and they interact with students. You have the right to a personal life. But just be cautious and think about things that can happen at your house at a slumber party on Saturday night. Your principal could get a call about, or your director of schools, right or wrong. I had an example years ago where there was a cheerleader sponsor that had a little slumber party at her home for, and the only children invited were the cheerleaders. Now, she told me that it wasn't a school-sponsored event. It was just, but only cheerleaders. They got into some mischief when she wasn't watching. And here's the thing. You can argue all day long that it wasn't a school-sponsored event. This was a private thing, after school hours. But if someone gets hurt or parents are angry about something that happens at your home, you better believe they're going to argue it was school-sponsored, because it was the cheerleader sponsor. The only people who were invited were cheerleaders. So just be careful about that. I always think about when I was in junior high, I had a beloved cheerleading sponsor that had a lake home. And she and her husband would have us, and we skied and had a big time. And I, of course, you know, then you become a lawyer. And then you practice school law, and you think, oh, my word. And you call her and say, don't ever do that again. You know? And you think about things that happen. Well-intentioned, but it could be somebody's incredibly injured. It may not be that you've done something wrong or the student's done, somebody got hurt. Sponsoring extracurricular activities and field trips. What I say to administrators, the people you select for these positions need to have the best judgment in the school, because they're going to have more opportunities for more intimate interactions with students. They're not going to be at school all day. They're going to be taking kids to competitions in Nashville or wherever, and in hotel rooms and in transportation. And there will be issues that arise that could not be anticipated or planned for. And you want to know that the people that have to make those decisions in the moment have the best judgment and react in a way that is the safest for students and staff and things like that. Because perception's everything. My favorite example of this is a group that took kids to some competition in Nashville. And on the way back, they stopped at one of the big chain restaurants. I don't remember, like Red Lobster or something, where they have the fruity drinks and with the cute glasses and the umbrellas and everything. Well, the teachers and the chaperones were at one table, and they all ordered those. But they ordered the non-alcoholic versions. But they, when you take pictures, they don't look any different, right? Before that bus had rolled into the school parking lot, it was all over town that the chaperones and the teachers were drinking while they were. It was not true. But you can imagine what a nightmare that was for those individual teachers and for the administrators having to explain, well, you know, you don't have to get alcohol in those, you know, fruity drinks with the pretty glasses. Not that they did anything wrong, but you always have to be thinking about how things could be perceived and avoiding that appearance of impropriety when you can. Don't violate the teacher-student boundary. Don't follow, okay, I have some rules, you know, and I joke and say don't touch kids. I mean, I'm just telling you to be cautious. This is a rule I really believe in, and I think most districts are having policies about this. Don't friend kids on Facebook. Don't accept friend requests and follow them. I've even been asked, what about their parents? You know, look at your board policy. I would find, in my opinion, there might be some parents that you did not want to friend or follow, and some you did. It's best for you to say, you know what, I have a policy. I don't friend students because of our board policy, but I also don't friend the parents of students. It's just, you know, the most ethical and fair way. And that way you don't have that, well, you accepted her friend because you just don't like me and you don't like my kid, I guess. Things like that. And people will say, well, how long after a student graduates, you know, that's for your board attorney and your board policy, but do not friend kids. It's just a recipe for disaster and in violation of a lot of your board policies. Be careful about out-of-school contact. I don't mean that if you see a student in the frozen food section of the grocery store and they come up and hug your leg that you're supposed to shove them away. I mean, no. But just be cautious about those interactions and having students to your home. And, you know, if you have a kid that you know is struggling and they trust you and maybe only you, and you really feel like you need to talk to somebody and get some guidance about the most appropriate way to help them. Here's one that I think is people forget sometimes. Avoid the appearance of favoritism. Do not give certain perks. You know, offering rides, that's a no-no for liability as well. Because if you're in an accident and you're seen as acting outside the scope of your duties, that could be personal liability for you. So most school boards are going to tell you, if you have not been approved to transport students, you are. And it doesn't matter if Sally's mom didn't pick her up for practice and you live right down the street and you know you're just going to throw her in the car and take her. Do not do that. That puts yourself at risk for false accusations, for an accident. Even if it's not your fault, somebody hits you. Don't do that. Paying for lunches or snacks, gossiping with some students about other students. Just be really cautious about that perception and that action. If a student confides in you about child abuse, self-harm, or potential harm to others, immediately follow the protocol for mandated reporting. Remember that the law says you have an obligation to report suspected abuse. It is not abuse that you investigate and deem, yes, it's true. It's suspected abuse. And good faith reporting is important. I have seen educators be prosecuted for failure to report. So err on the side of caution and report everything. And you know that there's very strict protocols now in the law for schools about you have a coordinator at your school. Just don't think, and I've had in the past, I've seen educators say, well, I'm going to monitor the situation for a day or two and just make sure because I just don't want to overreport. Suspected. It doesn't mean. And if you do your own investigation, what I have heard from DCS's attorneys is you could, in fact, preclude DCS from being able to properly prosecute someone who is being tried and convicted of child abuse. So they do not want you doing your own investigation. And that's part of the reason it's about suspected abuse. Okay, for your consideration. A male teacher hugs a sobbing 5-year-old girl who fell off a swing. Does the interaction constitute sexual harassment?
No.
Okay, remember, tweak the facts, answer might change. What if the same teacher hugs a 16-year-old girl who is crying because she did not make the cheer team?
Yeah.
Still a child, but different age, does that matter? What if he frequently consoles her one-on-one after school? Then we're kind of changing the facts where we're like, that's why these are hard questions.
I think you could probably, if there's a situation such as that, you probably don't need to be the one to at least instigate. I think you have to use common sense there and maybe more of a pat than a cute,
you
got to
think,
bear
Christy,
hug.
Christy said don't hug them. Let's see.
Yeah.
How can I?
I would do more of a consoling pat than I would a bear hug. And I would also wouldn't instigate any type of behavior such as that, because I'm sure someone's watching.
Mm-hmm.
If she's crying, somebody's probably saying, well, what's she crying for? Now, did she go into your classroom by herself? Now we got another issue. Yeah. Where are you going to be in contact with a student? So I think common sense, once again, has to come
common
in.
Common sense. And these are the kind of scenarios, these are things, come up with some of these. If you have tabletop discussions in your schools, make up some of these. Talk about it. These are the things that I think, you know, really what a discussion of teacher code of ethics should be about. Instead of just reading the, you know, here's what it says. You know, I think sharing and thinking, well, what do you think is a problem? Because sometimes there's no right or wrong answer because it depends on the facts. And in this case, obviously, in any of them, the teacher might generally care about the students. But when you're evaluating behavior, facts matter, perception matters. It's reasonable for a 5-year-old child to need comfort falling off a swing. Hugging is a common form. I'm not saying hugging kids is you can't hug kids. I'm not saying that at all. But I do think that it's something to think about. Now, high school speech and drama teacher and one of his students are always seen together, even during lunch. Sometimes the student stays late after school and the teacher takes her home. Fellow teachers have noticed their interaction but are not sure how to approach the situation. Others just don't want to get involved.
Get involved.
School districts need to support good faith reporting and conversations, and, you know, colleagues need to be able to say, hey, I know you mean well, but I don't think you need to do that. I mean, I think sometimes having courageous conversations with each other and having tabletop discussions in an in-service or planning day where y'all can talk and just say, I think this is a problem. If you've got somebody in the room who says, well, I see it a different way. You know, have those conversations. A teacher always asks a particular student to stay after class. The principal notices this and asks why the student must stay late. The teacher responds that the student is having trouble with some of the subject matter and needs tutoring. Should a principal be vilified for asking that question?
No.
No. That's protecting that teacher, probably. A young teacher frequently makes comments to male students about how handsome they are and how they will make some girl happy one day. She often says she wishes guys looked like them when she was in high school. Is there any part of this that's okay? Any part that's not okay? Where was the line? Where was the line crossed?
Just making comments of how handsome they are. That's not your role.
I think always commenting on students' appearance in that way, I would be very cautious. Now, telling a student, you know, you look really sharp in that suit today. Your presentation was great and you looked professional. And, you know, that's very different than saying you are so handsome. I think thinking about how, and then of course, wishes guys look like him. I mean, that's really. But I do think you have to be cautious about, it's like commenting on someone's weight. We just know we don't do that, right? And taking that conversation from a boundary teacher-student to something that's more like a conversation that you would have with a friend is problematic. A teacher often tells her students how smart and creative they are. She gives them high fives and fist bumps when they do well on class projects and assignments. She does this for male and female students. Is this okay?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a way. She's not saying, oh, you're so pretty or you're so handsome. She's saying, you're so creative and great, and we're going to do a fist. I mean, those are good ways, you know, during COVID, you know, the elbow, you know, we stopped shaking hands. And to be honest, I'm glad hugs were over because I've never been a touchy-feely person. I'll hug people close to me, but I prefer the fist bump to the big bear hug any day. Gerald, a second grade student, is seen crying by his teacher. He tells the teacher another student pushed him down and called him names. The teacher hugs Gerald, explains that he will be fine, and promises to have a talk with the other student. Any problems there?
Mm-mm.
No, I mean, I don't see some, you know. I think facts matter. The situation matters. Just a few more. Miss Smith noticed Kara, a 10th grade student, sobbing in the hallway. Ask her what was wrong. Kara informed Mr. Smith that she just broke up with her boyfriend. Mr. Smith gave Kara a side hug. She continued to cry. He told her there were many fish in the sea. He also said she was pretty and she would have no problem finding another boyfriend. Anything problematic?
The last sentence.
Just the last line.
Cut that last sentence off, right? Don't tell her she's... I think even many fish in the sea, whatever, you know. I think when you start talking about appearance and telling some... And it's bad that you feel like you can't tell someone they look nice, but I think it comes across.
I think the word pretty, if we could just leave that one out, I don't have a problem. So you can find another boyfriend. That's fine. But I think when you start saying, oh, you are pretty, then that might be.
Thinking about how to build someone's confidence up without just commenting on their appearance necessarily. So I think all that's to say is you all have wonderful opportunities to have great relationships with students and be there for them. It's just being cautious about, you know, how things are perceived. High school cafeteria worker notices a teacher and student teasing, tickling, and occasionally hugging each other in the lunchroom. This is the first time she's seen the two interact, and she is not sure whether she should report the behavior. You know, I think we all know that the behavior seems problematic, but I think that's a very natural attitude for somebody to say, oh, I don't, should I report? That is hard. That's what's hard about these situations. But I think in the school setting, administrators need to make people feel comfortable doing the right thing and making good and you know, good faith reports. Rumors about an 18-year-old male high school student and his female science teacher have been circulating in the high school for months. Students and teachers have heard of the two spending a lot of time together in between classes and even off campus. And I will tell you that every time there is an employment action and a licensure action, when people do investigations, it always comes out that there were many adults that had some piece of the information that thought, well, I saw something happen and I always thought that was a little, but I wasn't sure. What we can't do is have the whole school community know something's going on, but nobody says anything. That doesn't protect students. Okay, this is the statute that's part of the Teacher Code of Ethics that talks about the educator's obligations to the profession. I'm not gonna read it to you, but this is some of the do's and don'ts. Some of them are obvious. Deliberately make a false statement or fail to disclose a material fact related to competency and qualifications in an application for a professional position. I will tell you, years ago, we had a couple people that actually faked up a transcript. Our Office of Teacher Licensure came to me and said, Christy, something doesn't look right about this. And we have had applications for licensure where they actually forged signatures and made up their own. It's really, in most cases, it's easy to identify, but obviously that's a problem. Misrepresent the educator's professional qualifications. What I always tell people in our HR department, in our agency, is never hire someone based just on a resume. Because what is a resume? It's a marketing tool. And we know that people, they may not lie, some people do, but they definitely embellish. But that's a problem to do that. Assist entry into the profession of a person known to be unqualified in respect to character, education, or other relevant attribute. When it is known that someone has not behaved appropriately, and you get a reference check call. And most of the time, this is going to happen in the central office level. And lawyers will tell their client, school district, they'll say, always just give dates of employment. You know, don't say anything else. As long as what you're saying is the truth. For example, well, yes, they don't work here anymore. They were employed here from this date to this date. We had a complaint filed against them by a parent. And when we started to investigate that complaint, they immediately resigned. That's the truth. That's not defamatory under the law. It's not slander or whatever. I really hate it when people feel like they can't be honest with reference checks because I read an article once and they called it passing the trash. And there are lawsuits now. It used to be where it was more of the nursing home situation where you had people that did bad things to the elderly who couldn't self-report and they would get fired and then they would just go two counties over and get another job at a nursing home and no one would tell. I mean, that's a negligent reference. And you started seeing lawsuits over that. I have not seen one in the education setting, but you know, it's one of those things. Talk to your attorney, board attorney, if you ever have questions about what you can and cannot say on a reference check. But also, if you have a friend, and maybe they're a dear friend, and they've been your friend for 20 years, and you know they're probably not the best teacher because of X, Y, and Z, just be really cautious about, you know, overinflating their competency, or especially if you know of something they've done that's not appropriate.
So I remember, I'm from Minnesota. I've been here 27 years, but it was, you could not say why they were fired. But are you saying in Tennessee, if it's truth, you
there
can say
no
why?
There is no law. What is the concern when lawyers will tell their client, we don't want to be sued for defamation. We don't want to say, well, that person was I used to have this friend I worked with and he'd always say, oh, you want to know about so-and-so? If we had three more of them just like him, you could have them too. And I would say, oh, now I get what you mean. That was his way of giving someone a bad reference. if somebody asks you a question and says, would you hire them again? And you say no, how can that be? That's an opinion. I think that lawyers are very nervous about school districts being sued for defamation. But what I tell my agency, the Department of Education, and when our state special schools, I'm actually their board attorney, I would rather defend a defamation suit all day long where we said we had a complaint, we started the investigation, they immediately resigned and left and wouldn't participate, and that's all we know. We did the investigation as well as we could. We're not sure if it occurred or not. And they sue us for defamation that kept them from getting another job. I'd rather defend that all day long than not tell someone, yes, we investigated them for an inappropriate behavior with a student, and we fired them for it, and be sued, and then let them go somewhere else and harm another child and have to face that we put children in danger. So it's kind of, sometimes I always like to tell my client, which story would you rather tell? So, but you know, it's not a specific law, so talk to your central office or whoever makes those calls and your board attorney.
So you're saying it's not a law against saying it, it's just principals, administrators, whatever, shy away?
It's a legal risk at what you say.
So they can say, like you were saying, something very factual.
Yes.
We started an investigation, they resigned, and then stopped there, and you haven't really,
right.
All you've done is given facts.
I mean, you can defend facts that can be, you know, defamation, you know, you can defend facts.
Now, firing and non-renewal is a different animal.
And now there's a new law about non-renewal that.
But if that person is under contract for the year, and it automatically grows over June, whenever, and they're non-tenured, they're under contract for 1 year. To fire them during their contract, you have to prove breach of contract or cause.
Right.
Non-renewal means the contract is over and you're not going to bring them back the next year. That does not require.
Right. Teachers will call and say, well, I've been fired. And I say, well, you had tenure? No. And I will explain, like, well, teachers who don't have tenure have the expectation of a year contract. So, and so really being non-renewed just means they just decided not to renew your contract for the upcoming year. Now, when I first started, there were school districts, they non-renewed everybody until they knew what their budget was. We know now, I mean, if you get non-renewed, it stings, and a lot of times it might be an indication that you didn't get along with your principal, or maybe they thought you were a poor teacher, but it could be any reason, and they don't have to give you, except for in limited circumstances, reasons for non-renewal. So, you know, it depends. But most of the time, you all, unless you're sitting in the central office, but if somebody calls you from another school district, knows you taught with a teacher, just be cautious and get some advice on what you say.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yes.
So it was at one point like April 9th or something, and then it became like 4 days after the end of the school year.
Yes.
What is it right now? What's the?
It's funny. When I first started, it was April 15th. Then it was got moved to May 15th. Then it got moved to June 15th. And now I liked it when it was a date because every school district had the same date. And when people called me, I knew, well, it's this date. Now it's so many days after your last instructional day. So it's going to be based on your own school calendar. So what you have to do is look at when your last instructional day is, and that notice has to be given then. But here again, I would always be open-minded. I don't think just because a teacher was non-renewed necessarily means they're a bad teacher. It may be a personality issue with the principal. They just didn't get along. It may be a budget issue. So I always try to tell teachers, I know it stings, but it, you know.
Is it 4 days? I have people asking me this.
I don't have the statute in front of me. I think it's 5 instructional days, but I wouldn't.
So if they're a week out after, they're safe.
Yes. So those notices need to be, I don't think it's 10. I think it's 5. If you'll stay after, I'll pull the statute up directly. It's in Title 49, Chapter 5, Part 4. But like I said, when I first started, I mean, it's changed over the years. And what was happening is, what we heard is, if you tell teachers on April 15th, guess what, Christy? We're not going to renew your contract next school year. What do you think the teacher's motivated to do on April 15th when there's still a lot of school left?
We use a lot of sick days.
You hear that people talk about quiet quitting? Okay, here are the rest of these things. Making false statements about colleagues and things like that, that's an easy. Here's one I wanted to hit. Accept any gratuity, gift, or favor that might impair or appear to influence professional decisions. Around the holidays, when little Sally brings you that little bottle of Sweet Honesty Avon perfume, can you accept it?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, if you have a student whose father is a football player for the Titans, can you accept season tickets? What's the difference?
Value.
Is a gift, is a gift, is a gift?
The magnitude of the gift.
Remember, the language says that might impair
or
appear to influence professional decisions. Now, you'll have somebody that say, I don't care if they gave me a new car. It would never influence my decision. Well, that may be true, but would it appear to influence? So it's about appearance as much as whether. So that little bottle of Sweet Honesty perfume, I mean, nobody's going to think, well, she's going to get all A's the rest of the year. But if it's, and I would say a good rule of thumb, anything that's readily convertible to cash, I'd be really cautious. But some little token of appreciation and things like that, that's okay. It's the same way we have. Every governor since I've been working has an executive order on ethics, and one of the things is state employees cannot accept gifts. And there are some exceptions, tokens of appreciation, things. And, you know, I do a lot of in-service training, and I've gotten home where, you know, a lot of times they hand me a little basket that's got some potpourri and some pens and stuff, and it's cute and sweet, and I like it. I've gotten home, and it's like a gift card from, you know, Walmart for a lot of money, and I was like, oh, I got to return that. And they said, oh, well, just donate it. Well, even donating it would be a violation of that executive order because I'm the one choosing where to donate it, and it's a gift I've accepted. So it's the same thing. It depends on what it is, and there are ways to cure it. If you have a question and you receive something that's really uncomfortable, go to your principal, and they'll figure out a way to cure the issue or help you, because you don't want to hurt a student's feelings or a parent's feelings. But I do think that you might, I've heard from teachers who got themselves in situations where it was a bit uncomfortable because the gifts were pretty extravagant. But it's not just about gifts. It's about gifts that might impair or appear to influence decisions. Don't use illegal or unauthorized drugs. Yeah, that's kind of a no-brainer. Okay.
Christy.
Yes.
You can go to the State Board of Education website, go to their minutes. They will list every knucklehead that's done something.
Yes.
To lose their license. They'll list why they lost their license.
Absolutely.
And they'll list the reparations for that.
At the end of every state board meeting, most, there is a list of educators they've taken action. When I first started, they didn't even have a lawyer. They contracted out for those services. They now have a general counsel. They have a team of lawyers that is their entire job, is to investigate those situations and work with the board on what is an appropriate action. And you can hear about it, you know, what a teacher did. I remember hearing about when I first started, there was actually, where I grew up, there was somebody, and I heard the name and I thought, I know that name. Unfortunately, it was somebody I grew up with that they got their license revoked forever, and it took it all the way to the Tennessee Supreme Court, which, you know, lost at every level. Okay, let's switch gears just a little bit and talk about avoiding student accidents and just school liability. And I had to grab some memes for this. I'm Gen X, and I love this because I remember this merry-go-round, and some of you may have them out still on your. If you've ever played on this puke-causing, concussion-giving, bone-breaking, kid rocket-launching hunk of metal and survived. I mean, when you look at that now,
yeah,
you think, all right, what about this one? Just let them play. It's okay. There's no mulch. There's no, I mean, it's just concrete underneath. Hard chains probably going to cut their fingers off. You know, just let them play. No sides, hard ground underneath, and metal the temperature of the surface of the sun. I remember sliding down that slide at the Camden Elementary School playground on hard asphalt, no mulch underneath. It just hurts me thinking about, you know, that hot. I love this one. And this is when I say, if you find there's a dangerous condition present anywhere in the school, on the playground, always make note of it and make sure that it's taken out of play or out of bounds. Is this the way to do it?
Well, as long as the other side is blocked too.
Years ago, we had a diving board at one of our state special schools, and I talked to them. They said, it's broken, and we've roped it off. Well, the kids kept climbing on it anyway, and I said, get a screwdriver and take the thing off, because that's almost worse. We know it's dangerous. The kids are still using it. That's called a nuisance. How many people know what a tort is?
Such a legal term.
How many people know that it's not a little cake? My first law school class, 8 a.m. Monday morning, was torts class. I was scrambling, like, what's a tort? What's a tort? I know it's a little cake. I like torts, but this is a different tort. It's an actionable wrong, other than a breach of contract, for which courts will reward, damages. There are different types of torts. There are your intentional torts, and those are like defamation and battery and assault and, those kind of slander and libel under defamation. There are strict or absolute liability torts. And those are situations, if I'm engaged in a dangerous activity and people are injured while I'm engaged in that activity, courts may hold me strictly liable. So if I'm stockpiling explosives in my garage and it blows up and blows my neighbor's house up too, I'm probably going to be held strictly liable for that because I was engaged in a dangerous activity. It was reckless. It's negligent. The vast majority of torts are negligence lawsuits. And that's everything from somebody slipping on a greasy spot in the grocery store at McDonald's to a kid falling and hitting their head in your classroom. So when we're talking about accidents and injuries at school, most of the time we're talking about tort liability. Now, there's good news and there's bad news when you're talking about these types of lawsuits. You want to hear the good news? Well, let's start with the bad. The bad news is you can do everything right. You can have every appropriate policy and procedure. You can train everybody. You can properly instruct students. You can properly supervise them. You can have eyes in the back of your head. The bad news is kids are still going to get hurt. They're still going to do stupid things. There are things that you could never anticipate. They're going to get hurt in the cafeteria, on the playground, on a field trip, in the classroom when they're sitting quietly, supposedly. The good news is this. When courts look at these lawsuits, when mom and dad sue because Johnny got hurt and it's got to be your fault, courts don't like to say just because Johnny gets hurt or something happens that it's always the teacher's fault. That's the good news. And when you start reading some of these cases, I will tell you, I think it'll make you feel better. That if you're really paying attention, properly supervising, properly instructing students, and you're acting reasonable, in most cases the courts won't necessarily say that you're responsible. So, but basically negligence occurs when someone's behavior falls below an acceptable standard of care. Like negligent supervision. Bottom line is, when they bring Johnny and drop him off at pre-K or kindergarten, first day, they entrust that you will take care of Johnny. But when a court is looking at, did the educator act reasonably? Did the school act reasonably? They have a test of negligence. They're going to look at, did you owe little Johnny a standard of care? There is no way that you can ever argue that you didn't really. You know that old doctrine of in loco parentis, where educators are really standing in the place of the parents in a lot of cases at school. Did you breach that duty? Now, an educator can breach the duty of care through an act or an omission. They can do something that they shouldn't have done that maybe caused Johnny's injury, or they could fail to take an action that they should have taken, and that, omission caused the injury. There has to be an injury. And the court's going to look at, was that breach of that duty of care actually the cause of the injury? Were there other intervening factors? Was the student partially at fault? Or was it your breach that caused the injury? Now, I want to get to this about proper supervision, proper instruction. when you're trying to prove that you're acting reasonably, if you can show that you are properly supervising students when something happened, it's going to help you. Proper instruction. If you have students engaged in a more dangerous activity, and a lot of times I like to use trade and industry situations because, you know, sometimes the injuries are a little more extreme because they're engaged in a more dangerous activity. Maintaining school grounds and equipment. The worst thing that can happen is if you know that there's a broken merry-go-round on the playground, everybody knows it's been broken for 2 or 3 weeks and nobody's done anything about it. You need to regularly look at the equipment in your classroom. Look at the chairs. If there's a broken chair, you need to, and the minute you notice it, you need to take it out of service. You need to report, I need a new chair. This one, I'm not letting anybody sit in it until somebody comes and replaces it. This is a problem. Because it's almost worse to know and do nothing, because then you've created a dangerous situation. Document everything. If you've reported something to your principal, document that you've done that. And sometimes when people say, Christy, what do you mean by document? What do you mean by memo to file? Sometimes a memo to file is an email to yourself. On this date, I told Principal Ballard that Johnny came up and did X, Y, and Z, and he said he would take care of it and get back with me. You email it to yourself. You could prove when you reported it, you know, the situation. You may never need that, but sometimes you want to document that you've done things right. Yes.
Sometimes I've sent a thank you to the principal. Thank you for having the conversation with me about blah, 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 blah.
Perfect. That's documenting. Know what your board policies are. If you have a policy on field trips that, you know, all field trips have to be education related, they have to have a certain parent consent form turned in by a parent before, they have to be approved by the administration. Know what your policy is and follow it. If you have a policy on what kind of videos can be shown in the classroom, you may have a policy that says it has to be connected to the curriculum. But we all know that at the end of the year or at a holiday, you want to reward the kids, you're going to show a movie. I don't care if you're showing Disney's Finest. Somebody's going to be offended. You need to, and I hear from administrators a lot, and they say, I just need to know, I can properly have my teachers' backs if I know what's going on. So when that parent comes up angry about some video that you've shown in your classroom and the principal has no idea, wouldn't it be better to say, well, I followed the policy and it was approved by the administrator? I mean, the parent's still angry, but you're not on your own. So follow what that policy is and whatever protocol's in place. And by all means, don't show an R-rated movie. There was a parent that got really angry because their seventh grade student came home talking about seeing the Breakfast Club at school. And I called the director and he was like, I know, we've dealt with it. It won't happen again, you know. But, you know, the director was blindsided, didn't know. I mean, the teacher just decided to, but it doesn't matter if it's R-rated or not. Somebody's going to be offended no matter what you show. Students must be appropriately supervised during activities, especially ones including specific equipment. I'm not saying don't be creative, interesting teachers and do fun things in the classroom, but if you're doing something a little out of the ordinary, make sure you don't have a policy about it. Make sure that your administrators back you and support you in that. Even having outside, I love guest speakers. If you're doing a class on something and you have someone that's in the industry and you want to bring them in, make sure they understand what's an appropriate, what is age appropriate, what is not. They may not have children, they may not understand what's age appropriate, they may not understand, well, you need to stay away from these topics. And I've had some kind of funny horror stories about things like that. The rule of thumb is if you think your lawyer or your insurance carrier would have a heart attack knowing about something, probably don't do it. I get calls still every year about science teachers. Can we still give out those lancets and let the kids prick their finger and squeeze the blood onto the slide and do their own blood typing? I remember doing that when I was in high school. We don't hand out blades in the classroom anymore. There are interesting ways to teach that. There's fake plasma, there are lots of other ways that don't have that risk. So be cautious with that. Also, if you're a chemistry lab teacher or a trade industry teacher where the kids are engaged in more dangerous activities, if they have to take a safety test to participate in the activity, what are you going to do? You're going to make sure they pass the test before they engage in the activity, and you're going to save those tests. You are documenting what? You've properly instructed, you've followed the rules. I have heard from teachers where kids were hurt in the classroom, and they had to say, you know, Johnny passed the safety test. Johnny sat through my 3 hours of safety protocols, signed and acknowledged they understood them. He did something stupid, he was told not to, he got hurt, and now mom and dad are suing me and saying it's my fault. That has been the difference in winning or losing that lawsuit. It's horribly tragic when a kid is injured in the classroom, and no one wants that to happen. But protect yourself and document that you've done everything you could to keep those kids safe. And it works. What do courts consider when determining if a breach of duty occurred? They're going to look at that appropriate standard of care, act or omission like we talked about. They're also going to, every case you're going to read about, reasonable person doctrine. They're going to look at a reasonably prudent educator, administrator. How would a reasonably prudent administrator, teacher, or other school employee act under similar circumstances? They're going to look at a person with ordinary intelligence, ordinary physical attributes, ordinary perception or memory, and they're going to take into account any special skills. So if there's an explosion in the chemistry lab, they're not going to say, well, how would a reasonably prudent English lit teacher react under these circumstances? No, they're going to look at a reasonably prudent chemistry professor who knows about the Bunsen burners and the hot glass and, you know, has special skills, or trade and industry. When a tire blows up in a kid's face because they didn't follow the protocols and stay so many feet back and they overinflated and the nut was lit, whatever. I've had these conversations with trade and industry teachers, and it's a thing that can happen, and they know that it can happen. So they do take into account the special skills people have. I cannot finish the slides, so.
There was a student that died in the county I live in, and the teacher had said, do not hop on this motorcycle, do not, do not, do not. And because the student had some disabilities, even though every other student knew that they'd been told, the teacher, I think, was let go, because even though he had been given specific instructions, because of his cognitive situation, the teacher should have known better than to walk away from that dangerous possibility.
That is a perfect example, and what I'll leave you with, and if you look at these slides, I have some cases, some old actual cases at the end with some fact patterns and how the courts ruled. Look through those, and here's the deal. You can properly instruct students, but courts are going to look at things like, what are the age of the kids? What do we know about young children? You could tell them something and tell them something, and they may not listen. So that argument, well, I told Johnny not to do that, and he did it anyway, that might work better high school students. It may not work the same with younger students or students who have disabilities and who, you know, have issues because of their disabilities following instructions. And maybe a court would look at the, maybe you're a special ed teacher and you had a copy of that child's IEP and you knew exactly what that child's issues were, and you should have known, maybe a reasonably prudent teacher would have known that you need to actually create a barrier and watch that kid and make sure they didn't engage in that behavior rather than just tell them. So all of these cases, you know, you can't have a crystal ball, but these are all the factors and things that courts look at when they're trying to determine whether or not a teacher may have breached that standard of care and is actually responsible for a child's injuries. But I think if you read the cases, it gives you some good things to think about and resources to protect yourself and to make sure that you know, you keep your kids safe, number one, and that you can protect yourself. So,
can you repeat your email again to get the slides?
It's Christy, Christy.Ballard, Ballard, at tn.gov. And I'm sorry, I shouldn't have had, I get carried away and I have too many slides always. I should have. I'm still working on lesson planning, and but thank you, and thanks for being such a good audience. Y'all were very much more interactive than some, and it makes it more fun for me, so thank you.